I just want to make the acknowledgement to country before we begin. I'd like to acknowledge and pay respect to the traditional owners of the land on which we meet, the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation. It is upon their ancestral lands that the University of Sydney is built. As we share our own knowledge, teaching, learning and research practices within this university, may we also pay respect to the knowledge embedded forever within the Aboriginal custodianship of the country. I just wanted to also briefly introduce myself. My name's Kristen Utes. I'm the president of the alumni committee who is co-hosting the event tonight, the discussion. A lot of people are unaware that we actually have a committee called the Alumni Committee, but basically we serve as a conduit between the faculty, staff and present student body and the profession, the wider profession. And so we're a volunteer organisation, always looking for new membership and importantly to update your details so that you can also be a part of events and things that we organise through the committee. So that is over by the windows. Zoe, put your hand up. some sheets there to update your contact details in case you're not receiving regular emails from the university. And we'd welcome anyone who's interested in knowing more about the association, maybe put a little star next to your name and we can contact you. So we assist, it's a bit of a work in progress, but at the moment we assist the faculty in things like the end of year exhibition. There's a job market that we're starting for the student graduate master studio where potential employers come and look at the exhibition and with a view to possible recruitment. There's mentoring, guest lectures, exhibitions. 2017 is the centenary of the faculty, so there's some events already underway being organised to sort of celebrate people who've passed through this wonderful building, the Wilkinson Building, professors and esteemed alumni. So without further ado, I'm going to hand over to Justine, who is co-founder of Parlour, who has put together the exhibition here, and we'll moderate the panel. The panel are all friends and colleagues who are all alumni of this faculty and much celebrated in our profession. So I think it'll be an interesting discussion. It's a positive way forward. Thanks.
Great. Thank you, Kristen. Welcome, everybody. I should just say the exhibition was put together by Naomi Stead, myself and Jill Mathewson, who are, I suppose, really kind of key founders of Parlour. But we also worked with Mariam Goucher and Fiona Young, who are both here, who are great friends to Parlour, and we're trying to draw them into our little world closer and closer all the time. And we couldn't possibly have done it without them. So thank you, ladies. Anyway, it's great to be here and it's really great to have such a good turnout. When I was asked to chair this evening's discussion, I was delighted to see that the topic that Kristen and her alumni group had selected meshed so very well with the interests of Parlour. We work really hard to locate discussions of equity and gender at the centre of discussions about the future of the profession. We're not really interested in seeing these being relegated to side issues of marginal interest. And this was the basis of a symposium that we ran a couple of years ago, which some of you may have attended. Transform, Altering the Future of Architecture, asked, if architecture was more inclusive, would it also be more robust? For us, the answer is yes. And understanding what that might mean is part of our ongoing project. As my friend and colleague Naomi Stead writes, the question is not whether we can afford gender equity, but whether we can afford to miss out on its benefits. Only if architecture becomes more inclusive and equitable will the profession be able to fulfil its own potential. This, of course, relates to a much wider business case for gender equity. It's based on extensive research in a wide range of industries. The business case goes something like this. A more diverse workforce especially at senior levels, delivers better outcomes for a company for multiple reasons. Diverse voices lead to more creative approaches to problem solving, more robust overall decisions, and hence better economic performance. Diversity helps avoid groupthink. And there are also financial gains to be made from retaining staff, reducing churn, and the attendant return on investment in training and development. These findings, although we don't often talk about business and architecture, these findings are very relevant to our profession. Creative problem solving and better overall decisions are obvious assets in architectural practice, but they're also relevant to the wider profession. We need to ask, what does it mean for the profession to lose a significant proportion of its talent pool, which is a word I find slightly awkward, but you know, we know what I mean, at a time when the context in which we work are rapidly changing. The attrition of highly educated, skilled architects who happen to be women diminishes architecture's potential for change and renewal. If the profession is to adapt effectively to new environments, we need people, more people who think in diverse ways, not fewer. Of course, increasing the participation of women in the profession is only one way to increase diversity. There's many kinds of diversity, but it's the one that's been the focus of our work so far. And Sarah Wigglesworth, the British architect, writes, as people who tend to have portfolio careers, juggle competing interests, diversify their experience and make do financially, women are well placed to invent new forms of practice. But she also warns, time is critical, for if we don't do it soon, we may have no profession at all. The business case, of course, cannot be disentangled from cultural issues, and nor can it be separated from the social justice case and the ethical case. And it's not just enough to employ more women or to keep more women within the profession. There's a very good Deloitte's report that points out the story is not about the increased representation of a particular demographic group bringing extra sparkle to the workplace because of their special skills and talents. Rather, it's about organisations with a more diverse talent pool manifesting a workplace culture of openness, merit and rational decision making. At heart, the story is one of diversity and inclusion of all employees so that a richer knowledge bank is fully leveraged and better outcomes are achieved. So to be effective, equity and diversity issues initiatives need to engage with and remake the cultural context of workplaces and the profession as a whole. Because the cultures of architecture are not always healthy. Long hours and the glorification of them, unpaid overtime, unrealistic deadlines, low pay, presenteeism, lack of flexibility, low fees and undercharging, and sometimes just very bad management, are often quite deeply entrenched within the profession. Not all of it, obviously, but some of it. And are based in mythology rather than sense. There's no evidence that these habits result in better architecture or that they're in any way efficient. These workplace cultures are one of the things that drive women out of architecture. So, you know, it's a fairly grim view of the profession, but anyway, what might the profession of the future look like? A few years ago, I was involved in a project where we asked 40 women what they thought the future of architecture could and should be. It was a really diverse group. We explicitly tried to get a big range of people in terms of age, in terms of what they did, in terms of their experience, in terms of the kinds of practices they worked in or didn't work, you know, worked outside of practice. And what was really remarkable was the overwhelming consensus about the need for architectural work to be more diverse and more broadly defined. Charity Edwards summed it up in her response. I think it should be a lot more fluid, less restricted in scope, more engaged in political and local economies, and with about a million more options than currently exist in mainstream practice. We could argue perhaps that we need to open our profession to the possibilities that architecture offers, and we need to turn our design skills onto the profession itself. So to help do this, we have got a fabulous, Kristen has assembled a remarkable panel, which I believe she did very personally, putting the hard word on people. So we've got Camilla Block, Director of Durbach Block Jaggers, Rachel Neeson, Director of Neeson Murcutt, and also Adjunct Professor here at the University of Sydney. Stephanie Smith, Principal Architect at a large corporation. And Imogen Howe, who's an architectural graduate at the Alle, Jack and Cottier. So tonight's discussion is framed by some quite broad questions. How might we redesign the profession to support diverse and sustainable work practice? What would expanded definitions of architectural practice and engagement be? What would that offer both the discipline and the community? Now, they're kind of big questions. We'll see how we go. To kick things off, I've asked each of our panellists to set the scene by briefly describing how they practice now and if and how this has changed over time. I've also asked them to each make a brief statement about what they see the future of practice being, and I've asked them to be short and sharp in response to this, you know, enormous topic. But I think the idea is that by having everyone present a very, you know, short position statement, will provide very fertile ground for conversation amongst the panel. So we'll have a kind of, you know, a discussion amongst ourselves, and then we'll open up to questions from the floor. So as you're listening, please do think about how you would like to contribute to the conversation. But to start with, let's have Imogen.
Hi. Yeah, thanks, Justine.
Good luck.
So those are some pretty big questions.
Yeah.
In terms of me, I just want to say up front, obviously, I'm a new graduate, so I'm new to the profession, relatively new to it, and my opinions are sort of fairly kind of, they're growing, I have to say. But in terms of the way that I practice, certainly it's been evolving. I've noticed that in the last 5 years since joining the profession, and I've definitely still got a lot to learn, but as I'm going through and I've entered into the workforce, I've been gaining confidence. So I've felt a lot more confident to contribute directly to design decisions. Initially, when I left university, I was a bit more reserved. I took instructions directly from my directors and so on, and now it's much more of a round table discussion, and so that's really positive to see. That I'm welcomed into that sort of to be involved in that way. I've in the last sort of year and a half, I've actually been working in urban design within our practice, and that has actually had some influences on how I think. So I think that will always be engaged in the way that I practice, sort of thinking about that sort of urban design aspect and how you engage with the community in that way. I've also been tutoring at the university since I finished my first degree, and that has always provides a different sort of like insight into practice, and kind of keeps you fresh, I think, a little bit. So I'm really keen to keep that going. Also kind of keeps you in the loop with research and that sort of stuff. In terms of the future of practice, I don't know. I'm not exactly sure where that's going. I haven't been here long enough to see any really big cycles and shifts that are going around. And I do have hopes and fears, though. So I think my kind of big hope is that we have increased understanding from the public about our work and appreciation for what we do. I feel that that's lacking a little bit at the moment. And I really hope that as that happens and as we grow into the future, that our practice maintains a good trajectory to becoming more equitable and also more flexible. Unfortunately, that's really difficult at the moment, like you mentioned, with long work hours and overtime and some of those expectations that come with the profession. I've got a big fear. It's less related to equitability, but I've got a fear about architectural practice in that I worry that we're giving away responsibility. And this has been part of a conversation that's been going on for decades. I mean, I think, you know, since the 70s, we've seen the rise of the project manager, construction manager, and so on. But I think now with D&C contracts and so on, we're giving away more responsibility. It's not necessarily a bad thing. I think it sometimes reduces liability, and also it's really important to work with consultants and builders to realise these really complex projects. So it's great to work as a team, but unless we know how to manage some of our key priorities and to ensure that those continue through projects and work better in this way, I think that's a major risk to the profession in general. So yeah, that's me.
Thanks. Stephanie.
Hi. I have wanted to be an architect since I was very small, so I'll try and keep it short. I had a father who was an architect, and that probably inspired me to join the profession. One of the things he advised me early on was don't be an architect, and I always thought that was because I was a woman, but it turned out it was because I would never be rich, which was turned out to be true as well. But I stuck to my guns, misunderstanding him right from the beginning, so I thought, you know, I can do this. In the 70s when I was leaving school and the 80s when I was studying, it was a very male-dominated profession at that point in time, but I've never really come across a major issue with being in a male-dominated industry, and I think obviously over time it's changed quite significantly. I spent a lot of time working overseas and had a great experience there. I came back to Australia and spent 5 years doing research in Aboriginal housing, so spent time living in a marble palazzo in Genoa to a tin humpy in the back blocks of New South Wales. And then I did quite a lot of teaching and some lecturing, crits and tutoring and that sort of thing during that period. And afterwards, a lot of that was in Queensland and some time I spent here. My research, I had to spend some time converting it into a part of a book about a history of Aboriginal housing, so I've been involved in that part of the industry as well, and doing some reviews and critiques in magazines. Following that, I started a practice with my partner, which I found to be an amazing combination for a woman. I mean, it's my only experience of working in practice, really. Living with someone who understands exactly what you're trying to do, the hours you're trying to work, combining, you know, childcare and all those sort of things was an amazing opportunity for a woman. And I think, apart from the money, I would recommend it to women as an opportunity to actually really do what you want, how you want, when you want, and to have a family at the same time. The last 2 years of my private practice, I actually practiced on my own, and I found that a lot harder. It was an amazing contrast. And it was also post-GFC when work had been really hard to get and my whole incentive for actually being in private practice was waning quite significantly. I was lucky enough to have done some really exciting projects all around the world and, you know, of all different scales. So, you know, I looked at my folio and thought, you know, I've done what I came here to do. I'm really happy with the outcome. So I was really pleased about that. But I decided at that point in time to change my career completely. I thought about doing something else, but, and I think we all do from time to time, thinking, why didn't I choose to be a vet or something like that? Thinking, no, I wouldn't like to do that. And I kind of realised that I don't actually know how to do anything else. So I didn't really have a lot of choices. But there were opportunities to join other large practices. And, you know, at a certain point in time, I thought, I've been stuck with my own crappy systems in my own business. I don't want to really join in with somebody else's who are equally as bad, if not worse. And I got a great offer to join a large development corporation where I was given an opportunity to head up the practice and to be in a, you know, extremely senior role within the design component of that business, and to join in with something that I think in some ways is quite exemplary of where architectural practice may end up going a little bit more in the future, given that we're focusing a lot on sustainability and issues to do with what is the built environment and how can we occupy this planet in a more responsible way. And I think comparing that with working in private practice, it's actually very hard to pursue those ideals on small-scale projects in small-scale kind of chunks. So, you know, I'm excited about where I'm going. It's very different from working on your own in your own business, but I think there's a huge body of people in my business now who know what they're doing and they're top of their game. So that's a really exciting opportunity.
So my name's Camilla Block. I've I'm a bit tangential, I think.
That's good.
Maybe I rush read your email. I hope you don't mind if I read something to you. You can summarise my professional practice in pretty much one sentence. I've worked in the same place since I graduated, with the same people pretty much. I have two business partners, both male, and it's a small, you know, slightly neurotic, dysfunctional, eccentric, slightly sort of left field organisation that, well, organisation is probably a friendly term for what we do. but we sort of bump along despite that, and I wonder sometimes whether I'm inert. You make me feel inert, I have to say. I've never been in a humpy, I've never lived in a palazzo. I sort of been thinking a lot about the woman aspect of the questions that you raised. And I guess that's sort of not generally, it's not only about the broader picture of practice, but really about who we are and how we're working. And so I hope you don't mind if I read this. Can you hear me? I have to do a sound check for Mariam. Can you hear me? So I just would like to talk about three things in my sort of intro. The first is literature. So if you haven't read A Room of One's Own by Virginia Woolf, you must. So it was written at a time when a commonly held view was something like this. A woman composing is like a dog walking on its hind legs. It is not done well, but you're surprised to find it done at all. So Woolf is talking about how essential it is for a female writer to simply have a room where you can shut the door and £500 a year. In those days, what passed for an independent income. But what I found most amazing about Virginia Woolf's book is that she's talking about women at a beginning point. As novelists beginning to write, they're moving into a form where the greats are men. The form has been made over time by men. The thinking, approach, and inspired works are by men. And Woolf is asking, given this, how do we make literature our own? How do we not corrupt our work with a strident reaction or become too hastily absorbed into an existing condition? How do we get comfortable with our own voice? And at the time of writing, this is 1928. I mean, it's astonishing to read it, really. Women had been writing for many years. Think George Eliot, the Brontes, Jane Austen. That when she was writing, the process had well and truly begun. Sorry, it's only two pages, I promise. So architecture, like literature, is a shared and learned language, and we stand on the shoulders of others. Thinking about us in architecture today, with the exception of Lina Bobardi, all my great architectural loves are pretty much men. Our delivery system is pretty much also male. Think construction, engineering, project management. We are so new at this. We have so few role models. And who do we look ahead to? But please don't misunderstand me. I'm not talking about female architecture or anything sort of icky. I'm just talking about a more balanced choir of voices, the equivalent of both Austen and Dickens, David Mitchell and Margaret Atwood, George Orwell and Nancy Mitford. We are at the beginning ourselves, and so much is possible to make a new and androgynous bedrock. So I guess my open question to us all is, how do we make architecture our own? And my second question is about likability. So if you've read Lean In by Sheryl Sandberg, it just makes you want to cry, I think. There's a huge study that shows women's competence is considered inversely proportional to their warmth. And the number of children inversely proportional to competence. So we're basically screwed. So I suspect, and this is either a generalisation or a very personal view, that we are complex without being particularly robust, and work can be a bruising experience. Our armour is too easily damaged. Our belief in ourselves folds too readily. And to top it all off, Virginia Woolf herself says women are terribly hard on other women. So given all of that, my next point is a plea. Let's not inflict unnecessary damage on each other. And my last thought is about the future. I heard this fantastic thing that said men are promoted on potential and women are promoted on ability. So if we hang in there, if Hillary does get to be the next president, she's probably actually qualified to do the job.
Well,
I won't be nearly so eloquent as Camilla. I'm just going to start with some observations. The first one is, I think it's very important, it sort of touches on what Imogen was saying really, that we demonstrate the value of architecture. I guess in current lingo that would be design excellence, but you know, architecture is not free. It takes time, there is an upfront cost, but it's worth doing because it's purposeful and it makes us feel good as a culture. As a collective, I guess it's Vitruvius and delight. It's for sort of what I'm talking about. But it's really, I guess, an argument for not becoming irrelevant or how we can not become completely irrelevant because you feel it in the profession. The second thing is an observation that the environment in which we work is increasingly bureaucratic. So it's driven really... my experience by risk mitigation. You're asked to justify and re-justify and re-justify every single decision that you make increasingly. And it really sets the perfect conditions for precluding exploration and precluding experimentation. And so I think we have to work very strategically to navigate through this. An observation about workplace. I think, you know, we all, as men and women, aspire to rich and varied lives. And so for me, you know, for all of us, that's a fulfilling work life. And I think it's very important to recognise the effort in architecture. It involves so much effort. That so that in our office, we try to make sure that every project is valued, because that means everyone working in the office feels like their efforts are valued. That there's not a dud job that someone's been allocated. And that increasingly I'm becoming aware that you need to manage your staff by managing your clients, because that really affects the sort of the stress that your staff are under and also the workload, which, you know. The second thing to aspiring to rich and varied life is a life outside the studio. And in my experience, the key to that is flexibility. And I think it's very important to build a culture of trust in your office, in your studio, which involves, you know, open communication, so that, you know, I'm not really interested if someone's got a doctor's appointment, just go. I don't, you know, the only person who in the office who we insist starts and ends at starts at a certain time is the student. Everyone else, I've got no idea when they start. You know, their lives are their own. So I think that sort of flexibility is really important. And one of the early jobs I had when I left uni was with Philip Thallets, and it was a fantastic 5-year work experience. And with Philip, I also, Imogen, worked on urban projects, and that was great because you felt like you were having some sort of greater impact. I do remember one day when I was doing one of my own PJs, spending, I think, 5 hours trying to work out how to fit the microwave oven into the kitchen. And I just thought, oh, my life has not come to this. So, but the problem with working exclusively in urban design for me is that I felt I wasn't learning how to make things and not actually experiencing the spaces, because these projects take so long to come to fruition. So the arrangement I had with Philip, because Giles Parker, who now works with me, and I were two of his early staff, is I actually sublet a desk in his office. So it was incredibly flexible. It didn't feel like some new way of working. It was just a really logical way of working. So I worked on his projects. I worked on my projects. It was, I think I never had an experience of inflexible workplace, because that was really the beginning for me. Obviously, for me, the greatest challenge has been the death of Nick, because we worked hand in hand together so closely. I think after he died, I didn't even know how to get into my internet banking. he did everything to do with business, and I did everything to do with timetabling and programming within 3 weeks. We had separate private practices which evolved out of PJs, essentially, private jobs. It's very, you know, mine is such a mainstream, straight down the line story. And then we decided, our practices just fell together. And after 3 weeks, Nick said to me, "You do not have anything to do with fees or invoices because we will be doing everything for free." And I said to him, "And you have nothing to do with timetables and schedules and promises because everything will be late." And then we just did all the design work together. You know, I remember a beautiful moment saying to Nick, that was just such a good idea of yours. And he said, "Oh, wasn't that your idea?" You know, it was very seamless. So sort of unravelling that feeling almost of being one person was, you know, quite a challenge. And probably, I don't know, is there a difference between men and women? As a woman, as a person, I really like to collaborate. And I think, you know, reaching out to close colleagues and very close friends who are also architects, but also to the profession for help when I've needed, when I'm outside my comfort zone. I think that sense of collaborating in a collegiate way is really, really enjoyable. And anyway, sorry, I wafted on a bit there.
I'd just like to say,
I'd just like to say I agree with that too. The background of working in a team and in a group environment and workshopping ideas and, you know, talking things through and not forcing through one idea, you know, over the top of everybody else's is something that I've experienced a lot of as well, and probably you, Camilla, too, I imagine. I'm not sure. But I don't know if it's a women's thing, but definitely it's something that I think we're very open to.
Do you think it's because we're not, maybe when we first come out of uni we are, but a few years later we're not actually really frightened by doubt?
Yeah, probably. No, and so, yeah, not
self-doubt,
knowing.
Like, you know.
Not knowing or not necessarily having the best idea, yeah, or not necessarily being the best or good at something in particular.
I certainly suffered from that a lot immediately after leaving university. I really struggled to contribute. I mean, that's what I was sort of mentioning at the beginning. I really struggled to contribute design ideas because I just felt like, oh, I'm an idiot. I've come from uni, what do I know? You know, I'm working with this guy who's been practicing for like 30 years. Like, what can I contribute? I've kind of lost that a little bit now, and I think that will just continue to kind of fall away as I learn more and more. Because I still have things, I still have questions to ask that, you know, kind of prompt other ideas, and you always have something that you can contribute. I think even students really do. They can bring something out of left field that you just kind of don't think of. I wanted to pick up a little bit on the idea of flexibility that you mentioned as well, Rachel, because I was thinking that's kind of one of the key things, actually, is trust in terms of making people feel like they're part of a group of people or that, you know, work well together, or being able to, I think, also have a family and that sort of thing. It's important that someone's not looking over your shoulder and checking that your timesheet, you know, did you actually have a 15-minute break or did you have a 20-minute break and things like that. It's really important to make sure that you're working in that sort of comfortable environment. It means that you can think about maybe doing 3 days a week or whatever if you have kids, that sort of thing. So I kind of want that, resonates with me a lot. I think I've got a team leader who's very comfortable that I manage my time myself, so, you know, leaving a bit early tonight to come here was totally fine.
But I think one of the things that we've really tried to avoid doing, I guess, is say, well, women are like this and they do this kind of work, and men are like this and they do that kind of work. I think it's a trap for everybody. It's a trap for the women who fall into the cliches, it's a trap for the women who don't, it's a trap for the men, it's a trap for everybody. But what I suppose what we've been trying to do is, particularly by looking at statistics, is see what happens to women as a group, and to understand that some of that is around the way that we are enculturated. So who knows if we're more collaborative or not, essentially, but the way we're taught, the way we're raised tends towards many, but not all women, becoming good at that, and, some men are great at it, some aren't. So there's always this kind of tension between looking at the statistics and going, well, gee, that's shit. So what do we do about it? And not wanting to end up in the traps that seeing people as the big homogenous groups produce. And I think this sort of kind of interesting, there's always an interesting tension there. So in response to Camilla's question of, how do we make architecture our own? And in an environment where, collaboration is now seen as the key thing and BIM models and that, the sort of idea of the architect as the lead consultant and the trusted advisor to the client who manages the whole that's all kind of being eroded. So in favour of a kind, in a way that is both problematic and also opens up potential. So if we are taught to be collaborative, like where are the opportunities? Is there an opportunity to make it our own? I'm interested in what you three also think in relation to Camilla's question of how do we make architecture our own, or have you already?
I've got an answer to that question.
Oh, good. Excellent.
I'm a grandma, and I've got an answer to the question, how do you make architecture your own? I went to university when there are hardly any women, only men, and as a former shorthand typist turned English history major, I fell in love with an engineer. As a grandma of 68, the answer to how do you make architecture your own is very clear to me. You fall in love with a plumber or an electrician or a builder. Because I've only become interested in architecture or building since I retired. Because as a manager, part of a strata, and having gone through the global financial crisis and seen what happened to my superannuation in 2008, and trying to put all these things together and watching the price of Sydney houses rising, I've actually fallen in love with a number of young men in a completely inappropriate way, because they are actually the ones with the skills relating to digging holes, understanding where the shit goes, understanding where the pipes go. They are the people who are doing the thing. And it's too late for me, I'm sad to say, but if I had my time over again, let me tell you, I'd go to the football, and I hate football, but I'd find me a plumber, electrician, or a builder.
Go, Camilla.
I wanted to say something about... I think it kind of feeds into it a bit. I was thinking of it before that. Is that we really struggle from stereotypes, I think, in the profession. So, or not in just our profession, in all professions, we've got these stereotypes of a women's career, what is man's career, architecture, you think of it, generally, people think of men. He, the architect. Nursing, maybe think of women. Doctors, maybe think of men. Teachers, maybe think of women. There's a lot of things that we struggle with like that. I think that's something that we've got to overcome. Maybe there is an opportunity in collaboration. I mean, if women do that generally a bit better, maybe that is an opportunity. But I think it's not so much that. I mean, I think there's a lot of men that really want this to be an equitable place for women as well. And it's a matter of... just changing attitudes and perceptions, I think, or something along those lines.
Well, certainly our attitude would be that if you can make the profession more accommodating and inclusive for women, it will be better for men as well. It's not an either or, and I think one of the dangers is always setting up these kinds of oppositions. But, I mean, one of the things we're we're trying to do with the exhibition is give a more complex view of what an architect looks like. And that's not just about gender, it's about all sorts of other things as well. But, I mean, you know, just I think today there's a whole, there's something with the women in engineering posting photos themselves on social media. This is what an engineer looks like in response to something which I haven't quite worked out what it was yet. But, you know, there's the Tumblr, there's, you know, what does a philosopher look like? What does a scientist look like? And I think there's lots of things to do, but one of them is to change the impression of who we are and what we look like. But Camilla, you had something to say.
I mean, I have so many things to say, but I mean, first of all, I don't think you can marry your way out of a problem. No, unless you marry money. Okay. Anyway, you know, I actually think it would be really smart to marry money, and because actually there isn't enough money in architecture. There isn't.
Yeah, yeah.
And one of the things that I think you do you're a professional, you need to be able to delegate some of the crap that goes with raising kids and looking after a house. And it's not possible if you don't earn the kind of income that our clients earn.
Yeah.
Because they have dog walkers and food choppers and picker-uppers and God knows what else. And we are actually trying to do all of that ourselves, which makes it actually very difficult. So I think money... rather marry money rather than a certain kind of profession. Plumbers can be quite wealthy, so, you know, I'm not fussy. But what I was going to say was quite interesting that we sat down for lunch with our office. And we're more than 50% women, which really annoys Neil at the moment. And I said, I'm speaking at this thing and it's about women and equity. And it was like the men hung their heads like, oh, you know, like, sigh, here we go again. And it was like we were saying emotions or, you know, menstruation. Because they just fled and opened spreadsheets, you know, madly. And they were not interested in coming. And the voice of what we say is not heard. It is heard as, you know, lactation and emotions. And I think that's weird. Like, it's good that there are men here tonight, but I do find that it sort of seems to be, it's like a kind of eraser word, women and equity. It's like people just hear it and erase everything they've heard before. And then you start hearing words like engagement and blah, 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 blah. And you, it's very hard to make clear points.
Mm.
It's very hard to have a clear discussion. What is it actually about?
And I think that's why, you know, certainly when we wrote the Parlour Guides, look, there's very clear social justice and equity issues. We're talking about the business case like this. And I completely agree. I think one of the major problems in the profession faces is doesn't make enough money to do what it does. I think, and you know, Sarah Wigglesworth, who I quoted before in the same piece, is like, well, if we're going to fix things, we need to raise our fees. And it's not just about that, it's also about being taken seriously by other professionals and by... But that's not something you can do individually as a practice. That's something that the profession as a whole needs to engage with. And I don't think better business practice is going to be the only... You know, it's going to fix everything for the equity issues, but it will help a lot. You know, I think the whole unconscious bias is another whole question. But... earlier, I mean, Rachel, I'm interested in your division of labour with Nick, which sounds... earlier this week, a young Melbourne architect called Monique Woodward sent me a TED talk, which she loved, which is, again, from the business world, looking about why women cluster in the middle ranks of the profession. And I thought it's really interesting. The argument is that women tend to get mentored in terms of leadership and relationships and confidence and collaboration and you know, how to negotiate better, all this stuff. Men tend to get mentored in terms of how business works and how they can operate in it. And the woman who'd done this research was pointing out that this was completely unconscious. These people were mentoring men and women very differently without even realising they were doing it. But that it meant that women then trying to climb up the ranks to the sort of top couldn't talk in terms of business strategy and business acumen and achieving outcomes for the company, and therefore were not getting promoted, even though they covered all the other bases. So this architect in Melbourne who employs, you know, is a practice of four, there's two directors and two employees, is now you know, this is the thing about big business, is sending yourself off to all these business classes, shifting the way they practice. And I thought that was I just thought it was interesting, and it rang bells with, I mean, we don't all need to be good at business, but some of us do need to be good at business, and in terms of, yeah.
I'm quite impressed with some of our colleagues who, you know, get business coaching, business mentors, and, you know, I have to say my business plan's to break even. Business is not really my strong point, but it's interesting. We're doing a collaborative project with a practice with, you know, three male directors, and you know, the director. Like, I sometimes think, especially after you've had children, you've got such a limited time in the day. You just work through it. You're so efficient, and if I watch, you know, these men I've met in sort of at the top of their practice, there's a lot of time wasting that goes on. And that's actually really important, because that's high-level kind of time-wasting effective communication. You know, it's I went recently to this business lunch where we were just taking the clients out for lunch, and it's just very interesting to... I wondered about that question about the sort of mid-level, whether we sort of all operate so sort of... or many of us operate so sort of efficiently. To get to other level, it's almost... like you have to catch things on the wind, and you have to be more circumspect and sort of... I ran into some trouble earlier this year with a project manager, a male project manager. It was a terrible sort of incident, really. And I thought I was just getting the job done as quickly and efficiently as I could and helping everyone just move through the job. And actually, inadvertently, I was stepping on his toes. And what I wasn't doing was ringing him up and speaking slowly and saying, how was your day? And just chummy-chum getting on. Because I haven't got time for that. But that was a really important lesson, you know. So I have been actively, like, scheduling in, ring the project manager, have a chat. there's been some big lessons this year.
What's the time? Just check the... Oh, goodness. Sorry, I'm just checking time. do you want
to... Yeah, I was just going to say that you're asking about working together. Mm. You know, obviously, my business partner, Ken, and I work together probably a little bit like you two as well. We divided some of the admin roles and all the design work we did together. There were definite things that I obviously was better at the business side of things and the programming and everything else to do with the admin. And my business partner was more focused on the sort of the dreaming. But the time factor is really important, I think. Yeah, having those moments where you can just think and just relax and just sort of move around and network and negotiate things with people. And, you know, that is something... he was definitely... inefficient as well. I'll add that too. It was a positive contribution, though. And the other topic that you raised was, what can architects contribute? Definitely the idea is the principal one, I would think. But not only the idea, but having the confidence to actually know that you can take the idea right to the finished product. Mm. And I think in some ways... if you want to generalise, men, as you're talking about the potential, tend to have that level of confidence that they can actually deliver, whereas, I don't know, my tendency is that, you know, I have these self-doubts, or, you know, I need more information, or I need people to talk to sort of collaborate and make sure that I'm doing it properly. And so the reason I think that a lot of men do dominate in the industry and become well-known and get more buildings built is they have that inherent confidence, and they're one-on-one, they can stand up there and say, this is my idea and, you know, I'm going to do it like this. Whereas, you know, my tendency would be more to say, well, I think this is a great idea, I know I can do it, but, you know, do you think it's a good idea?
Yeah. And sometimes I think it's simply a matter of recognising those patterns and going, well, in this situation, I might have to play the game a little bit differently, and in this situation that pattern works, but... you know, they are cultural patterns. They are patterns of how we're socialised to behave and how people expect. Yeah, I think it's interesting. Yeah.
do you?
Oh, I was just going to say, but I think as well, yeah, taking time is important to see those patterns. You need to sort of step back.
I'm kind of interested too in what a, I suppose, what a career is. And I think Stephanie's career seems, you know, it's kind of particular, well, complex and interesting. And I'm interested, I suppose, in relation to that, to the sort of broader discussion about what architects might do and what might be seen as being part of the profession. And I suppose I have a question. I mean, Camilla and Rachel, you're both within relatively traditional model of what architectural practice is. So my question is really, do you, it's not that you should go and do something else, but do you think, can you achieve the kinds of things you want to do within a traditional framework of practice? And what are there opportunities of stepping outside that you see, or is it kind of, can you do what you need to do in that framework?
You know, I actually, I sometimes think it's crazy the way we take on more and more and more stuff that we're not actually particularly good at. And I really like being an architect. Mm-hmm. I like the fact that when I know what I'm doing in, and it's not a narrow sort of field by any means. It's incredibly complex, and you have to be very agile, and you jump at problems probably in similar ways, but the problems are often very different. Mm. But it's inventive, it's about making, it's incredibly interesting. I mean, it's incredibly stressful, and it can be, I constantly feel out of my depth. You know, I can't understand air conditioning. Okay, it defeats me every time. You know, I have to relearn what a condenser is every time.
Don't you have employees for that?
No, that's the point I'm trying to get to, is that actually I don't like the model where you become an executive and you do a little sort of dream on a paper and then somebody delivers it. Because I think, and I think that's the model that our office follows, is that all of us at every level are drawing, documenting, we're on computers, that's how we work. Mm-hmm. So I can, you know, we had this crazy situation where we were working for a big corporation, I won't say who, where actually I was the so-called director in charge. The drawings were checked by me, but sometimes the drawings were done by me and checked by me, and sometimes the drawings were actually done by me and checked by the guy who was the project architect, because I was acting in all the roles up and down the ladder, because I want to draw the handrail, actually. Not always, but when it's an important design decision, or I don't necessarily want to do the car parking, but up to a point, I really enjoy the act of piecing and building together, and I like the fact that we stay very hands-on, and that's one of the reasons why we stay the size we are, and one of the reasons why we like to stay involved from beginning to end in a traditional architectural role. And I know there are lots of ways of practicing and collaborating and becoming social geographers and you know, all these things that they make exhibitions about in Venice, but I sometimes think we forget how to be architects. Because that's kind of where we started, and that's what we chose. Mm. And I that's what I like.
I think the kind of idea that it is a discipline. I mean, for all the multidisciplinary things that get talked about, it is a discipline, and you're making a strong argument for being a discipline and taking that discipline very, very seriously.
Yeah, but also having the authority, and it is true, sometimes you have to hide your self-doubt and you have to hide and bluff your way through situations, because people are looking to you for an answer. To some extent, they don't want to say, oh, you could do it like this, you could do it like that, you could do it like this. And we have optionitis like crazy in our office, but we try to disguise it in some situations to make it seem like, yes, it's simple, make it easy for you, this is what you should do. But I mean, I love options, because I think that that's a really interesting way to work. And in a studio environment, doing many, many options is a kind of gymnastic. It's elastic for your brain. It means everybody can contribute. Anybody at any level could come up with the idea that you use. You just all bump in and throw out whatever you can think of. And it should be a free process. It should be anything goes. And then when you choose something, that's when you have to have some kind of rigor and certainty and not look like this sort of rudderless sort of beast.
I think wanting to open to questions, is it? Yes, I think it's about time for that. And Rach, did you want to?
Do you want the
It's really carrying on from what Camilla's saying, but I was just thinking of one of the ways to, you know, value what the architect does is the education of an architect. And it is such a diverse profession, and we do have to daily handle such a complex array of problems, managing so many different people. And there are not many other professions that deal with so many other levels of people, from the client through to the consultants, the authorities, the bureaucracies, plus the subcontractors, the builders, down to, you know, it's this huge sort of, I mean, I'm not saying that's the hierarchy, but it's a very complicated role that you play. And I think that is such a, it's something that we really underestimate. It's such a skill. It can be applied to so many other avenues and so many other areas. And I mean, the only other sort of, I'm sure there's more, but I'm thinking like a film director is probably one of the other more similar sort of roles where there's a vision that you are trying to realise, and it involves coordinating and communicating on so many different levels. And I think that perhaps that's something we really take for granted, and that I think if we understand what the education of an architect is, and that there's a myriad of possibilities for where that education can go. Mm. I think we're only just the tip of the iceberg, really.
Does anyone want to respond to that? Or?
I was just going to say that I've come across some really fantastic clients in sort of more institutional public clients where architects have moved into that role. Mm. And the agency that those people have, I mean, they're almost more effective than the architect who's actually making the thing. Like, to actually be able to help set up and steer a project is such an incredibly important role that I have immense respect for architects who do that. And I think it should be almost pushed as a career path through the universities, because it's a really, really important role.
And it's a role I know a lot of people who've moved into that kind of role. And I suppose one of the things that always slightly alarms me about the way the profession sees itself is it doesn't see those people as being part of it anymore. And yet they're playing really, as you say, very important roles, using architectural knowledge, using architectural expertise. So while I suppose my position would be very much that, while I also kind of completely agree with Camilla about the profession's own thing very seriously and doing it very well, I think if the profession could envisage itself as also having these other roles or having people with architectural, it would be a kind of broader and richer profession.
I think.
No, I'm not saying you don't, but I think the profession as a whole doesn't. If you're not registered, you don't turn up. If you're not, you know, yeah, well, except for you, Camilla. No, I do think that institutionally, the profession has a pretty narrow view of what it is to be an architect. And that is not necessarily about gender, it is about roles. And I do think that it would be to the benefit of the profession to open its mind to what one might do with an architectural background and include those people in the discussions, not go, oh, well, you've left. Yeah. I speak about myself in the same way.
On obviously some of the extremely large projects, you know, you can't do without all of those other people. And certainly where I'm working, a lot of the project managers who are architect trained are doing an amazing job, and it's a job I wouldn't want to do. Mm. You know, in a large-scale project, I'd like to focus a lot more on the design aspect of it rather than doing all the programs and the schedules and the, you know, who's got to do what next and what was said at the meeting and all of those things. But if they don't have an architectural background, there's quite a different perspective on the outcome and how wedded they are to
promoting whether or not the idea actually gets built. So I think there's it's a strong case for having, as you say, a lot of architects involved in other aspects of the building industry so that the ideas become built products at the end of the day, not just watered down sort of concepts that never really got there.
Do we have some more comment from the floor? Okay, there's lots of people.
Hi, my name is Rena and I've been in practice 30 years this year. I just wanted to make an observation about the conversation we just had. We had comments about that we use a lot of stereotypes, and in fact, I feel that some of that happened during the discussion. Both you, Rachel and Stephanie, talked about your partners, male partners, both architects, as being ones who were inefficient, late, unreliable, and not capable on business sides. And both of you took over the business side of things because that's how you share the job.
No, not me.
I'm not saying that they were not great as architects, okay? Because architecture is not all about business, but it is also about business. And what I heard us talking in here was that somehow women lack confidence. None of you do. I'm just wondering how I have been teaching here for 25 years have enjoyed that tremendously. I'm aware that one of the things that in practice what happens is that women need to develop confidence and leadership skills. And one of the things that did that for me was when I became pregnant, when I had no choice but to take courage to do my own practice, because when I was working for Philip Cox and Partners, I found the way that the women were treated in the office was not one that I wanted to be treated, and I didn't study to be treated like that. So when I became pregnant and gave birth to my son, I went, right, that's it, I'm going to do my own business. And that's 30 years ago, and I've been running my own practice ever since. Thank you to Philip Cox. I got so-called kick in the ass. And part of the thing was this. I found these conversations, corporate conversations. People had a lot of time after 7 o'clock to keep going and drinking beer and so on. I had to feed the baby and I had no time. And I could do the job, I could build my house, I could do the ski lodge, I could do other things, I could even teach in here and do all these things while working on my own practice, because I would choose when I worked. And I didn't waste time on useless conversation. I found a lot of that in corporate culture. And once I discovered that, that gave me fire about dropping my sense of trusting in my own capacity to run my own practice. I have just come back from North Coast. I was invited to very quickly help with a project where I got, like this lady just said, I got a plumber, I got a carpenter, I got an electrician, and a client, and I laid out the whole thing in 1 week. I've never worked so hard, so quickly, but the whole thing is happening right now as we speak. They're building already. I'm not a man. I did build two or three houses for myself as an owner builder. I learned a lot from doing that. But our skill as architects is not in being a plumber and a carpenter. I can't do any of that. I do have a son who is a carpenter, and I do have a son who is an architect, but the carpenter is actually... But anyway, I can't do electrical things, I can't do plumbing things, but as an architect, I can coordinate, I can see how to put it together. And my builders come back to me, they actually line up and they see the sketches and they say, I want to do that project, can I wait for a year? I'll be tendering, because they appreciate the overall, the design capacity that I have, so that what they do actually looks good.
Okay, makes sense. We need to let some other people.
Just wanted to mention, because I think the practical thing, I just wanted to share the making of it, okay?
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I think Renna raised an interesting point that we haven't touched on so much, is that architecture, it is very much about the making, and that's a really wonderful aspect of it. But it is a business as well, I mean, as most careers are. But there's this business side of it that we do need to not let go of, because a lot of architects are not so great at business. There are a lot of practices that are suffering because they're not good at business, and unless we get better at that, I mean, I think that's another way we become more irrelevant. Mm. We don't know how to promote ourselves.
Okay, someone here?
Thank you. Hi, I want to ask about support and the support women get, especially for younger women like myself. I'm architect education, but I'm in development now, and I found it extremely difficult to actually break from architecture. And what I want to know is, do we need support if we are going into that kind of masculine? And if we do, what kind of support do we need? And my observation, and this is really what happened to personally to me, is that I applied for a role recently where I didn't get a call back, but as soon as my mentor, who's a very well-known architect, enforced me, I actually got a call and I was asked to go on an interview. And it raised my doubts about, was it really me, or do you actually need a male, very strong male support to actually go up the ladder? Thank you.
I'm not sure it's about male support, but I think it's about support, and I think it's about a network and talking to people and letting people know what you're interested in and what you think your skills are and where you'd like to move. And what you'd like to move towards. So, you know, that phone call could have been from anyone. It could have been from me. It could have been from Camilla or anyone. But if you don't let people know what you're interested in, then they can't step in and help you when they think that you might need a helping hand. So communication is a really big one, and not being afraid to express your ideas about where you'd like to head. You know, so if you want to be the next Prime Minister, you know, tell people that you're interested in that, and you start to set your career path and your goals in that direction.
Some of the research that I was reading in the preparation of this is that often women struggle with being assertive. Not all women. But I think that's a key thing, is that sometimes you just have to think, well, I am qualified for the job, and maybe I just need to somehow make myself heard, even, you know, if I'm not immediately.
There's also an idea of the sponsor, which is different from a mentor. So, and the idea that, I mean, there's quite a bit around at the moment saying women are over-mentored and under-sponsored. And a sponsor is someone, exactly the person you're talking about, who's more senior to you, in roles where they can recommend you, where you're never going to be in that room, but they can go, well, she'd be good. And I think, I don't think you can just go, well, it wasn't me, it was because of who I know. It kind of was always often about who we know is what gets you the foot in the door. It's what you do after that that also makes the opportunity for yourself. But I do think that idea of having people who are prepared to speak up for you and your skills and your ability is really important. It's certainly been important to everyone I know. And, you know, the people who will recommend you because they, you know...
I think it goes for everything too. I think we've long been under the misapprehension that, you know, people who get widely published, you know, got there just because of what they did. But if no one knew what they were doing, or they didn't talk to other people, or they didn't have sponsors, or they weren't part of some group that promoted a joint idea, and they were part of something that was jointly promoted, then they wouldn't necessarily get to that level either. So I think to think that just because you're doing something well or because you'd like to do something, you're going to get there, it's never been like that. It's always been about who you know, who knows about you, the contacts that you have, and the network that you're working within, I think.
And I think operating in that world with integrity is, it's not about...
It's not about just knowing people because they'll get you somewhere.
It's not about just working in the room.
I mean, that's pretty, yeah, transparent.
Okay, another quiz. We've got... All right, sorry. Hi.
Is this working? Yes. Hi. My name is Jenny. I just wanted to allude to two topics that have been talked about tonight, and one is architecture as a business. I think, generally speaking... architecture as a business is not really taught at university. You have one half of 1 year that's deals with marketing and that's it.
Sorry.
So I think that's something that's sadly lacking in our education generally. I'm also on the executive committee of SPUN, which is the Small Practices of the Upper North Shore, and so I deal with a lot of small practices there. And things like... I send out the emails via MailChimp and that sort of stuff. So I see everyone's email addresses. And a lot of these practices have really dodgy email addresses. And I've been given people's business cards where they've crossed out their name and number and just handwritten it on there. And, you know, just crap like that. And it's like they have their business cards printed for free. And it says on the back of the business card, this business card was printed for free. It's like, seriously, are you expecting someone to spend $20,000 with you for a year if you've got a shitty email address and a free business card? It's like that is not projecting a professional, you know, presence at all. And and they're men, they're not women. It's not a women's issue. It's a professional issue. Yep. And the other thing is all this time wasting about the blokes having chats with their mates. That is not time wasted, my friends. As we're, I don't know if this is a female thing, but, you know, I was always taught growing up that you sit in a corner, you work really hard and someone's going to come and notice you. That's bullshit.
Yep.
No, you've got to get out there, you've got to tell people what you're doing and you've got to have everyone notice you. And that's what those time-wasting conversations are all about. I'm currently working for a building company where one of the directors is a former wallaby. And I see the emails and I see walking around with him in town... meeting clients was really an eye-opener to me, just the nature of the conversation and the nature of the, you know, the informal, hi, how you going, how is the rugby, blah, blah, blah. And 2 minutes later, that guy has said, oh, I've got a space upstairs, you want to have a look at space planning it for me? There's a job, you know? So that you could argue that that was a wasted conversation, but 15 minutes later, he's got $100,000 worth of work, thank you very much. And that's what we as women don't necessarily do that well. And all those time-wasted conversations are not wasting time.
Well, Rachel's scheduling them in now. I couldn't agree more. Yeah. And I think one of the things that Ali Giannini in her piece on Parlour is like, we need, you know, about building other networks. So there are networks and there are networks. We need to build our own and, you know, I think we're doing that. Look at us. Who's next? Yes.
Tonight we've been saying a lot of things, but we've been saying two things in particular that I'm hearing. One, we're worried about our profession getting smaller and smaller and our responsibility being taken away. And we say that as a negative thing. And two, we're worried more and more about the fact that we're not business people and we can't run our business like somebody that has a master's degree and an MBA or something would run it. So, why don't we embrace the fact that our responsibility is as designers and we should just focus on design and do what we've been taught and then try and outsource things like practice management, things like marketing, you know, the things that we don't want to deal with, project management.
I guess cost is an issue with that. But yeah. I think that's a really... important thing to sort of tie into. Maybe we don't do it so well, but I actually think that there's that's just something that people are overlooking. It's not like you can't get advice on running a business. It's not like you can't get training in business management. I mean, you can, and that would automatically probably improve a number of businesses. Yeah, the free business card with names scratched out, it's not a good look. Yeah, that's a major issue, but
I mean, like Rachel was saying before, I know a lot of architects now who are getting business coaches and finding it saving their practice. On the other hand, I think there's definitely something to be said for you're not an expert in everything. You're an expert in many things, but also having professional advice. So get a business coach, get some marketing advice, get, you know, make sure, get a good accountant. So I think, yeah.
I think the first step, though, is if you're starting a small practice from PJs, which, as you say, often most of us do, you don't have the spare money to do that. So you build up gradually, and you're always focusing on trying to get the next job and trying to do it as well as you possibly can, and probably the fees aren't that great. So you've got to reach a certain critical mass before you can actually afford to outsource. And if you've reached that level of critical mass, your business skills probably aren't as bad as you thought they possibly were in the first place. So perhaps it's about, you know, the people who haven't quite got to that critical mass, what can be given to them, maybe through the university environment or somewhere, that will help them get to that level before they kind of crash and burn, or just spend the rest of their careers kind of, you know.
Well, the other thing I do is edit the website of the ACA, which has got lots of business advice on it. So,
can I say something?
No. Okay, we've got lots more questions. So quickly, and then. Sorry.
I just want to say very quickly, like, there is a perception that architecture, good architecture, takes a lot of time, like a lot of time. It's a very labour intensive, we're never adequately paid for the time that we spend. But to Rachel's point, that actually we're incredibly time poor. Okay. Do you think, and it's a question I guess to you all and you all, is that is it possible for us to do our job slightly differently so that it doesn't rely on just endless man hours, woman hours. You know? She's Justine looking at me. You know, there is that
endless
manual
man hours,
component.
But very focused and efficient woman hours.
I'm not sure how it works with you guys, but I think that sometimes the fee doesn't really reflect having the time to make some choices and so on. Sometimes to have some ideas, you actually need to give yourself a bit of space, or you need to iterate. And sometimes you've got a project manager or a client, you know, on your back wanting drawings every single week or wanting something every few days. That's really difficult to have that space to kind of make, you know, have ideas. So, yeah, maybe it's about increasing fees or something, but I don't see how you can do that without changing perceptions of what
it
is that we do.
Yeah, it's about the impression of value that.
Yeah.
We share. Can I just say briefly? We share a studio, Camilla and I, and I'm interested in at the moment. Camilla's office is changing software, so I'm sort of looking over the joinery to see if it improves their efficiency. So, because it's quite an outlay, and I'm sort of thinking, you know, those sorts of things where maybe there are things you can do in the way you practice that might save some pain.
Definitely.
Archicad. You find that clients just expect more if you've got the software.
Well, that's
what makes
client,
it a bit easier.
No, that's where the client management comes in.
Because it's less for me to manage them, I guess, but I try to. But sometimes you just get a call, you know, can I have this, you know, because they know that it's just really accessible and easy to produce something. But it means it pauses other tasks.
I don't know. I think, I'm the really at fault here, but I think you can actually train your clients.
Mm-hmm.
You really can. I mean, I'm being terrible at it, but I think you can. And it's my New Year's resolution to better train my clients than my staff that gets so stressed. So, yeah.
I've heard that a lot. You know, you just got to say, I've heard that from a lot of people around these conversations.
We can do you the 27th option. You just have to pay our salary rates.
I just, I'm almost shifting the conversation ever so slightly. I just want to say a massive thank you to Kristen Newts for assisting organising tonight. This has been a fantastic conversation. You're really opening up the world of architecture to so many people. It's so great to hear you all speak. And thank you, Kristen. I was taught by Kristen. I was one of the very first students in a small practice with two young children. And I remember Liam running in, going, "Mummy, Daddy," with the paper tube. And I've just had the benefit of working with them for 5 years. And I'm honoured to be here to be now teaching with Kristen and to be a part of these conversations. I think all of you have shared so much wisdom, and it's just been fantastic. Thank you.
Is that the end? That's great. Well, and I think it's very, it's, you know, we do a lot of doom and gloom, so I think it's pretty good, you know, to have them.
Hi, my name is Kaylee. I actually just wanted to touch on software and architectural technology. I'm quite involved in the BIM world, and I see a real shortage of female participation in that space.
Yep.
I think it's a real concern for the future of the industry and for women in the industry. If women are not sort of on board early, they will fall behind in that space. Does the panel want to comment on that?
I have to comment on this. Because I am learning ArchiCAD, and you know, I'm not 50 yet, but I'm almost 50. And when we decided to go across to a three-dimensional CAD system, I thought I would be the last or one of the last people in the office to be learning it. But as the cards have fallen, I'm actually the first. We have somebody who's joined our office who's trying to train me, you know, which is a big chore every day. But it's fantastic. And actually, I think for the first time in a long time, I think you can actually get back some autonomy from it. Because it's three-dimensional, which I think is sometimes lacking in how many documents we produce that aren't three-dimensional. And it's great brain training, you know.
I'm a bit older than you, Camilla.
Not much.
And, I'm learning Revit. So there we
are. ArchiCAD. Revit. ArchiCAD.
Actually, I think most of the women in our office are on BIM software. We're about 44% women at AJC, we've got a team of about 10 people that are what we call CAD coordinators. So these are the people who review that all of our CAD systems are, you know, quality managed and consistent, and all our drawings go out consistently and stuff. And about half of those are women, so they're fairly well represented in our firm, at least.
If you're at conferences and seeing who's presenting, and again, maybe it is women's fear of putting themselves out there and putting their work up, but even at a lot of the social events, again, the time-wasting beer drinking, it's very, very male-dominated, particularly in Sydney for some reason.
I've got no practices who are specifically looking for women. They want people in, you know, BIM, Revit, whatever. I can't do any of it. They can't even get any applicants, and they're particularly trying to get women. So I think I agree with you from what I hear. There's a very good piece in the American publication, The Architect, by Daniel Davis, trying to start to think about these things. So if you want to write for Parlour about it, we'd be very happy.
I'd just like to add, I think we have about 30% women in the design.
Your large corporation.
My large corporation, yeah. And everyone's being trained in Revit at the moment, and serious BIM coordination, clash detection kind of Revit. And I think that's something that the practice has been very dedicated towards, and you know, they've engaged a Revit trainer full time to be in the business to do that. So I don't think there's been any kind of, well, they won't be any good at it, or they're not interested in it or anything. And in fact, maybe no one's given a choice, but it's definitely where it's going.
Certainly for students and young graduates, I think you should skill up if you haven't already.
Yeah. I just wanted to say, though, she touched on that, you touched on, Kaylee, that people were dropping off at senior levels. That's not just a problem in BIM management. That's consistent across senior management in the profession generally. And they tend to drop off at more senior levels, I think, women across architecture, and that's consistent in other professions too, not just in architecture. So
maybe they met the plumber, finally.
Okay, next. Another question. We've got 5 minutes.
Hi, I just wanted to touch on some of the points that you've made. We've talked about collaboration, leadership, and the role of communication. I think these are really important skills that we probably should be learning right from the start at uni. We do a lot of group assignments where we're working with each other at the same level, collaborating on design, but we don't necessarily work as much with other disciplines, or we're in a position where we're actually learning how to lead a team of people and convince people of our ideas and network, which are all those important skills that lead into marketing and business development along the way. Yeah. And the other one that Imogen just mentioned was, as people move up through the ranks, I think we were talking internally at AJC about our office has struggled with, when people come back from maternity leave, dealing with part-time work and the role of a project architect not being able to be dealt with in less than 3 days a week.
I could talk about this for 5 hours. Perhaps I should let one of my panellists speak first. Has anyone got a response to that, or shall I just let rip?
We have a number of women and men working part-time. I think, though, the interior designer, female, is working 3 days a week, and she's one of the only interior designers in this practice of 200 people or so. So she's got quite a heavy workload, but she's managing to hold that job. And there are another number of young mothers who are working 4 days a week and project architecting on very large projects. I don't know anyone who's 3 days a week doing that role, but definitely four, which is a start. And there are a couple of men who are also 4 days a week because they have young children as well.
I was just going to say, it's been like the elephant in the room. How do we look after our kids and be architects? But I gave a talk a couple of years ago, and it was at a place called the Queen's Club, and afterwards there was a dinner, and I sat next to this young architect who had had a year's maternity leave, and she was wanting to return to the workplace. I didn't have a job for her. But a friend of ours, Andrew Burgess, rang me a week later, and I said, I'm looking for someone. I said, oh, I've just got the person for you. I just think women who've had a year out of architecture or two and want to come back to the workplace, and they just want that kind of thinking space, I just think they're the best people to employ. I really, really do. And when one of my staff, who's now set up her own practice, Isabel, she came back, I think, initially she came back 1 day a week. That was great for me. 1 day a week, we had a project that you could service 1 day a week with a little bit of mobile phone stuff on the side. It was perfect. But I also do think, and I'm only speaking from a small practice perspective, that there is also a limit of how much part-time a practice can handle depending on the project. Some projects don't actually work part-time, but a lot of them do. After the GFC, a couple of months after the GFC, you know, Nick and I were thinking, well, we've got to be a bit careful, and everyone went down to 4 days a week, and I think everyone was 4 days a week for about, men and women, for about a year. Well, we had so much trouble getting everyone to go back to full time. You know, there was like, oh, it's my yoga day. it was actually quite fantastic. And, you know, for a year we ran, you know, an effective office 4 days a week, and everyone was, in fact, a little bit happier.
Interestingly, Alan, Jack and Cottier did that too. So we actually went down to 4 days a week, and that actually, we managed that all right. We didn't have a lot of stuff under construction, admittedly, at the time. But that worked all right, 4 days a week. But I think that with the scale of projects that we're working on, I don't think we could do easily less than 3 days a week. We don't really have any houses. We don't have... so everything's kind of requiring a lot of input. So I don't know if it's a scale thing, but maybe it's not working so much in the more like the bigger kind of commercial offices or something. Going like, if you wanted to there are a number of people who want to come back only 2 days a week, and it's really difficult not to give them really piecemeal tasks that are just a bit of photoshopping here and there. You know, we've had one woman who came back recently. She's back 3 days a week, but our HR manager was on leave for a while, and she really struggled finding meaningful work. She's a registered architect, and so that had to be remedied to get her onto project work and so on, because you can't be giving a project, you can't be giving a registered architect Photoshop jobs.
Glorified student work. There's lots of women coming back from maternity leave doing glorified student work and ripping their hair out. Yeah. Camilla, do you have something to say before I open my rant?
I'm like you. I there's so much to say about it, but I think you can't avoid the sort of central truth of it, that your career gets disrupted by children. And it's very hard to recover. Mm-hmm. And I think it's a conundrum that I don't know what the answer possibly could be. I mean, I'm almost impressed at people in our office that have taken a year off. I think I took, I don't know, 10 weeks off or something, and I was on the phone, and actually I hate that. I hate the perception of that I'm a superwoman, look, I'm still working and I'm in labour. You know, it's just rubbish. You actually have to focus on children, you have to do a good job. It's also an unending job that you can never do well enough. And I think we need to model the kind of behaviour that we think is acceptable, but I think a lot of women my age have modelled a kind of behaviour that is not acceptable. Which is, you know, they go home, put the kids to bed, go back to work, stay there till 11 o'clock at night, have a hacking cough, look like shit, never do any exercise. You know, I don't think that's good behaviour to model for the younger generation. But I don't know how, given that, how you preserve a role in the office that's meaningful. And I see it over and over again, equally talented pairs where the guy progresses, becomes more and more able, more and more talented, more and more challenged, and the woman idles in the same shallow water, even though they started off equally talented at university. And mm-hmm. I don't know how to fix that.
Mm-hmm. I think one of the things we haven't talked about associated with that possibly is working remotely. Certainly, you know, being able to work from home or being able to be in another place or another city or another wherever and doing jobs. You can do jobs that are offshore via telephone and email and whatever. You can also work from home a couple of days a week and do those things. I think the industry is embracing that a little bit, but it's certainly something that could have far bigger impact and still be effective.
I think there are some practices that do it incredibly well. There are some practices who really successfully manage people working part-time in meaningful positions to their full capacity. Mm. There are a lot that don't manage it at all well, but there are some who manage it very well. I think the other question, and one of the things I want to do with Parlour actually is start doing some case studies on those that do it well at all different scales, because there are big practices that do it well, there are small practices that do it well. Yeah. But there's no doubt that returning to work after having children and wanting to work part-time is the place where women experience the most overt discrimination and the most difficulties. And even if they're not, it's not overt discrimination, it's the most difficulties. Men who want to do it also experience problems, and sometimes more so, because they're seen as an absolute career killer. Lots of people leave and set up their own business as a way of managing that. If you want to work on big projects, that might not be the answer. Mm. But, you know, look, I mean, I think there's things like job sharing, which happens very rarely in architecture, but which happens in medicine. It happens in very high-powered things where people's lives are at risk. If they can do it, surely architects can work it out. And I think the other thing, thinking about the business matter, is that the long-term costs of losing those people, because they're just, quite frankly, bored with doing another render, to the business are really substantial, and it's probably worth some short-term pain. Having said that, I acknowledge that I think managing too many part-time people all at once is really hard. But, you know, look, I think it's the, you know, not all women are the primary carers of their children, but in Australia at the moment, most are. Not all women have children, but it is it's a huge issue, and it's the one which, in terms of our research, has really struck me the most. It's the thing that I've been most struck by, really, out of our research, because prior to the research I would have said, you know, it's a red herring, women without children also experience career delays, men have children too, you know, there are big structural issues that aren't about children. There are, but the thing of children is it's very hard to manage.
You can't actually do everything.
You can't. And you've got to look after your kids. Someone's got to look after the kids.
So for me, being pre-children... This is a really terrifying issue for me. This is a major thing for me. I've got really big aspirations. I've got lots of things that I want to do. And I'm thinking, oh, I'm 28. I'm sort of getting to a point where I kind of need to start thinking about this. Am I going to do this? When am I going to do this? How am I going to do this? I don't want my career to go on hold. I've got things I want to do. I've got so much to say, stuff I want to do. But, yeah, it's massive.
We might workshop with you afterwards.
I think when you have children, you also realise that architecture isn't the only thing in the world. You know, so your divided interests become your interests become quite divided. I'll rephrase that. Yeah.
You also develop a whole lot of networks that you didn't previously have that can lead to all sorts of opportunities. So it's not, you know, I think the other thing that our research has really identified is the huge mismatch between people, men and women, but particularly women, working part-time who really feel they're focused, they're efficient, they're productive, they just do great stuff, as Rachel's saying, and the perception, they're not fully committed, so we can't, they're only, you know, we've got some terrible comment in the survey responses from some bloke going, oh, we tolerate part-time women, but we serve our clients so well that really we just, you know, we can't have them, too many of them. It's just... You know, there's just these very, very big perception issues which actually have nothing to do with management or feasibility, or there are some jobs which it's very hard to do part-time. The other question is what a career is. And a career is not necessarily a start here and a churning up the top. A career, and women's careers tend to be atypical. They go up and they go down. They have moments, they have periods of intensity. You know, I know lots of women in their 50s who are just firing because they've got through that stage and they're ambitious and they're doing stuff. But it's, if you kind of get off the ladder and can't work out how to get back on, it's really hard. And I think you're right, it's very hard to... I do think you're a superwoman, Camilla.
Yeah, but kids get older. Like, that's almost the shocking thing, is that suddenly, you know, my oldest is 17. Like, you know, he just, besides sort of washing and food, he's gone.
Can he learn Revit?
No. Maybe. Well, yeah, but it's interesting because you suddenly see that it's short term and it's not that it's cyclical, that actually you move through it and it's poignant, really, that you get to a point where you think, actually, that's it, that was my shot to be home and to be with the kids, and don't waste it.
Yeah, I'm with you. I admire the people who took a year off.
I'm just jealous.
We're running over time, but do we have one more? Anything? Oh, Beverly. I think we definitely have to have Beverly.
I'm probably, if not the oldest woman in the room, one of them. And I was thinking,
nothing's changed.
Yeah.
But at least something's changed. The younger women are at least having the children, whereas my generation did not have the children. I did, thank God. And I'm very thankful, even though he still calls me from London, his bag's been stolen, the passport's gone, can he organise it at 38? No, I've spent I don't know how many hours the last 2 days sorting out the money and the passport. Whatever, I love the bastard. But I want to say, to me, one of the real problems is women not believing how good they are. And you're all bloody brilliant, you know, and you must believe you're brilliant. And if men are so bloody good, why is architecture the worst paid profession just about? Now, it's also, I came from a medical family of lots of women doctors. I had a wonderful grandfather who, out of 13 children and 2 wives, had 6 women doctors. They all worked.
Two of them were the first medical graduates from Melbourne University. They didn't ever believe they couldn't do medicine, couldn't reach the upper levels of medicine. So why are we still here thinking we can't do it? If business is so hard, why are the men so bad of it? And also, business is not a dirty word. I believe women can do it. It can be inventive. It can be done well. I watch some young women who are not architects, who don't have to work with men. This is a problem. We do have to work with men. Even though I love some of them and don't love others. There are two young women, my office is in a group of seven shop houses in Catherine Street, Leichhardt. There are three women with businesses in those shops. One is a 27-year-old, stunningly beautiful dressmaker. She's making the most beautiful gowns you can ever see. She's gone into that business, set it up. In 18 months, she's got a fantastic business. My own shop, I'm moving to the back. I'm renting out the front because, like typical architect, I did renovations. The budget blew out, so I need some money. A young woman, less than 30, I think Arabic background, is setting up a holistic health business in the front of my building. She has no fear that she won't be able to run that business and do it and be successful. I mean, for me, it's just fantastic to see these women have this self-belief. And why don't we as women architects have this self-belief? It absolutely bamboozles me, and we should get over it.
You know, I had a question here about, you know, role models and all those things, and I think it's very important. You can't, you know, this. I was in Tasmania recently saying you can't be what you can't see. Well, we've all seen you. We all see these people. And I think that sense, this is a very long-term project. People like Beverly have been on it for decades and decades and decades, and I think that's incredibly important. We're doing our bit right now. Beverly continues to do her bit. This will not go away quickly. Things won't change quickly. It's a long-term project. We'll hand the baton on to another lot, but we all are making incremental changes, and I do think that we have some fabulous women, and here they are. And there's...